You're on, Sam.
All right, I'm on. Excellent.
Play it, Sam.
All right, well, I will play it. All right, so, hey, everybody. This is my talk, Nix, the Good, the Bad, and the Useful. I have two different email addresses. I have this one, and I have a talk-specific one that's going to show up on slides. Hey, y'all. Thanks for having me. It's going to be real good to talk to everybody. So why I wanted to give this talk, I wanted to share my feelings about a useful thing that I'm learning about and I'm using. I've been using this technology for about 3 years, and I haven't gotten bored yet. Second reason is I wanted to try a different approach to introducing things. Others don't really focus enough on the underlying theoretical basis of the tech, which I think is like the reason you should use it. So like this is kind of an experiment to see if there's a new way of introducing the topic. And then, like you said, polyglots is a lot about conversations and like the amazing things that I've been able to hear and talk about with people since we've been having. It's been really great and awesome. And so I kind of wanted to contribute to that. Those conversations by kind of adding a new topic to the conversations. And I have some contact information. I know some people said that they wanted to be here, and they weren't, so you can contact me online. So it's talks.nix, or talks+nix. I'm going to try to make that a special high priority email inbox so I can get to people quickly. So what I'm going to be talking about, what is Nix, which is kind of an overview. We're going to talk about the Nix store, which is the awesome good part. We're going to talk about the language, the bad part. And then kind of the Nix build system, which, you know, sort of ties those two together in something that's useful. And depending on time, we're going to cover some other parts of the ecosystem, and then I'm going to end with some conversation starters, some specific questions I want to kind of start asking. So, what is Nix? So, first off, it's a new word that was invented by the folks that invented it. Nix comes from the Dutch word nix, meaning nothing. Build actions do not see anything that has not been explicitly declared as an input. So like this idea of, you know, seeing nothing unless you're specifically told, that's like a very central idea in the entirety of Nix. So that's why I kind of want to start off with that. So the other thing is it's a functional programming package manager. That's how it defines itself. And the idea is that packages are the immutable outputs of pure functions. So like whenever you're thinking of Nix, you should be having like a lambda calculus function in your head. Like the idea is that S is the specification of a package, and then P is like the resulting package, and it's supposed to be pure and mathematical and all that. So that's kind of the image in your head you should have. Of course it falls short at times, but that's the goal. Another thing that Nix is the functional programming DSL for specifying those packages. Writing a code in this language is, spoiler alert, the part I don't like. And then beyond that, we've got this entire ecosystem, an operating system, DevOps tools, declarative user configuration management, and much more. And finally, in my opinion, I think that Nix is a breath of fresh air for building, configuring, and packaging software. So, what it isn't, well documented. I don't really want you to like read the text so much as just look at the area. This is a bit of a configuration management tool called Home Manager, and the blue line right there at the bottom is their documentation for how to use it on macOS, which is just says to be done. That's it. That's the entire documentation for an entire platform. So this isn't unique to Nix, but I wish I could recommend this as a tool, not independent stuff. I just realized that my phone was still on, so that way. Okay, so it's not a good DSL. I personally like to think of it as if Haskell and JSON had a baby, but they couldn't agree on parenting styles. Like, you'll see what I mean when I get into it, but that's kind of like what I think of it. It's just, it's not good because it doesn't really fully commit to one thing or another. Also, if there are any good arguments against anything that I'm complaining about, like, talk to me. Opinions are like armpits. Everyone has one. Most of them stick. And that includes me. So, I wanted to put that in there. So, no software is perfect. I said this project was a breath of fresh air. Fresh air has bad smells, too. So, that is. Now we're going to, I kind of want to give a taster of why it's worth talking about. So, Nix has a unique approach to package management with min useful implications. So you can install, upgrade, and roll back atomically. All those operations are atomic. It can help with difficult dependency management. You can share reproducible build environments in source and binary forms. And you can also just learn another DevOps system with a terrible syntax. But I actually like DevOps, except for the language. And the other thing is that all this kind of radical stuff and some of its approach, it does inherit and reuse tools that are like known for being useful. So like the default build environment's really close to Build Essentials and Debian. It's got a lot of CLI tools that I'm going to show in the slides, so you can use sort of normal scripting tools with it, and most of the options are also configurable with environment variables. So it's very much a classic Unix tool in that respect. So the first thing, the good part, the part I want to enthuse about, is the Nix store. So like this is the motivation for learning the less good parts. I'm going to first kind of give a generalized, almost straw man-ish depiction of other package managers. Mostly just for contrasting with what Nix has to offer. So one thing is with the file system hierarchy standard, you've got lots of different directories containing files for programs and configuration separately. So this is a screenshot from Ubuntu, and it's a description of all the different files that are in the Emacs 25 package. So like, I know the text is small, but it's like, the main one I wanted to kind of point out was like /user/bin/Emacs25. So you've got like that file is sort of like where the binary goes. And you've got a bunch of other little files in different places, all based on the file system hierarchy standard. Emacs and elist packages are installed in /.emacsd. Emacs configuration files are at home or elsewhere. This is just sort of all over the place. And that's fine until you need to update. Whenever you update, the data at, say, /user/bin/Emacs25 is overwritten. If the update process crashes or is interrupted, it'd be in a partial state. Many mechanisms prevent this, but Nix does it differently, as people see. Another term I've heard used is that the file system is a mutable global state. And then security concern, man-in-the-middle attack. So in order to make sure your packet, when you're downloading stuff over the internet, in order to make sure your package hasn't been compromised on its way to you by a man-in-the-middle attack, you need to verify it with a cryptographic hashing process. Typically, you download the hash the server has, perform the hashing on your computer, then compare the two hashes and make sure they match. Some package managers do this automatically, say pacman with arch, but some don't, and you have to do it by hand. But, like, the worst case version of this is curl into shell. Like, that's the worst one. Verifying packages happens everywhere. And then the hardest part is all the different parts of dependency management. Dependency management is really most what a package manager does, and when it goes wrong, your packages are broken. And when the best standard you have is Semver and Firefox doesn't use it, you've got a hard job on your hands. That was a terrible joke, I'm sorry. And the hardest part is actually the concurrent dependency management. And I think this is kind of why we have the kind of package management is the way it is, because it's such a hard problem. So like, how do you do that? How do you manage it? Do you use a child group? Do you use sandboxes? Do you use Docker? Maybe this is the reason why every language has their own package manager and builds and like tools on top of it and virtualization and stuff, just to kind of get a handle on concurrent versions. So, now that I painted this picture, I want to bring up Nix. Nix does it differently. And this graphic is supposed to be, like, originally this is going to be a graph with all the dependencies, but you could not read the text on the screen, and so I replaced it with like a tree thing. There's like a bunch of text that doesn't make any sense, but I'm going to go through it, and we'll figure it out. So the first thing that Nix does, compared to other package managers, is that it cryptos all of the things, everything. Every package it builds, every time it builds them, it hashes them. And it hashes all the dependencies. And so the verification step and the build step are one and the same. And changes to the package result in different hashes. And every package has a unique ID based on its contents, and therefore, man-in-the-middle attacks are less likely. Like, I'm not really a security expert, so I wanted to make the claim that that would never happen, but that seems foolhardy. So, all the packages that are built by Nix go to this directory, /nix/store. So this breaks the file system hierarchy standard, but we'll get to that in a minute. And the directory template is hash-name, or hash is the hash from the build. So here's an example. We've got this Nix package for curl. That was the gobbledygook you saw earlier. That was the dependency tree for curl. And you can see the path here is /nix/store/sha256hash-curl, and then the version. So like this is a specific package in the store. So let that sink in a little bit. So the next thing is that dependencies are included in the package. So if you look at the thing for Emacs, and there's like some of the command got truncated there, but within the directory you see movemail, you see rcs2log, profile, hexl, like all of these programs, like hexl is like, I think that might be distributed, but like all of these things are commands that normal package managers, Emacs would just assume that kind of exists in the file hierarchy, but in Nix, they're all included. Like all the dependencies travel with the package, like carrying luggage. So that means that dependency tracking happens during the build step. This mitigates the broken dependency problem because each package brings their own. So its installation, and this is the brilliant part, it's all done with Synnex. So if you look at the curl, the binary for curl, on other package managers, it would be something like /user/bin, but in this case, it's a symlink to somewhere in the store. Now, in Nix OS, which is what my laptop is running, like the thing that curl is pointing at is like this /run/current system, on and on. But you could have something like the FHS, all in symlinks pointing to the store. So you kind of have instead of having a global mutable state, you have a view on something else. Oh, also, I don't know if you noticed, but the file is for curl is dated at the beginning of the epoch. That's because Nix resets all timestamps. So like whenever you're looking at it, you're going to see that they're all the same timestamp.
Hold it. I got to ask a question.
Yeah.
I mean, that's not a why. That's a why would they do that?
I'll get to it, but it's part of the like this immutable deterministic kind of like erasing side effects kind of thing. So like the files in your file system don't get modified that way, but the files in the store, they're all the same times too. So installs are just siblings, and then updates are also just siblings because the installation is just a sibling to the store. Updates are just changing the sibling of a package with a different hash. So like whenever you update curl, it goes from that one hash to another. So different versions, different paths, same store. Because changing a package changes the hash, each different build results in a different path. The next store keeps paths around as long as there is a reference to them. So packages are immutable. Only additions, no updates, which means all versions are concurrent versions, all of them. It's just the problem is just gone. So whenever I kind of figured that out, my mind was blown. And I'm assuming that yours as well. So we're going to have an intermission to kind of keep the mind blown from being too much. So I want to talk about the derivation file format back to this lambda. So derivations are the unit of composition in Unix, or in Mix, sorry. So it's a file, surprise, it's JSON. So here is the derivation for JQ being piped into a shell that's running JQ so that it can parse and just pretty print the thing. And I had to like chop it down to fit the slide, but yeah, it's like, I'm going to use more shell tricks later on, but so like a derivation is just a JSON file, and the JSON file has a bunch of fields in it, and the idea is that the derivation contains all the information that Nix needs to build a package. It's that seeing nothing mentality. It's like everything you need to know is in this file and nothing else outside the system. So where dependency tracking happens is in this key input derivations. So you see the top one at the end, it says standard end linux.drv. That is the build essentials derivation that everything is kind of based off of. So like everything has this like build essentials core, and you just layer things on top, like layering layers in a Docker image or layering layers in a Photoshop file. That's how composition happens. You have this kind of base thing and you just lay things on top, and that's why they're called derivations, because it's a package is derived from whatever it's depending on. Okay, so that was a quick aside. I want to cover even more implications of this system beyond solving concurrent dependencies. So caching, everything's cached already. It's not just on your machine, it's for every machine. Like one of the things that Nix ships with is a web server that you can use to serve your build artifacts with other machines. And because it's cryptographically hashed, that means that it's the same across machines for the most part. Like, I'm gonna get to that in a minute. So installs, updates, and rollbacks are atomic. Because siblings either point to something or it doesn't, install and update actions are never in a partial state. And because previous packages are still available when you build one, a rollback is exactly the same as an update. So Nix has this mechanism called generations, where each iteration of an update to an environment is tracked by entries in the store, which means that your package actions are version controlled. And so like this is the last five generations that my machine's on. And so the current one is just a sibling pointing to a place in the store. So if I wanted to roll back, then it's just changing the sibling. And so I want to tell you this quick story of sadness and hope. So this month I was working on my laptop I was basically refactoring the Nix code, and whenever you're messing around with drivers and things on Nix OS, if you don't include them, they go away. And I did not include the wireless capability on my machine. machine when I updated it, and so I wound up with this like airplane perma airplane mode machine, and I was like, oh, I'm gonna have to like take the laptop to the router, plug it in, download the stuff, rip it in, all this stuff. I mean, because that's what I did when I was first working without even know about this. I was like, wait, I don't have to do that. Like, with Nix, whenever you reboot, the grub menu just has like 30 generations. So I rebooted the machine in the grub menu, and I was like, go back to the previous one, and magically, well, not really magically, but all the stuff came back, and I was able to get back online. So I was able to like fix my code error, and then move on with my life. And I thought that was incredible. So that was kind of like one of the things I was thinking about when I was first considering giving this talk. It's like, yeah, that was a really amazing thing, and I would love to have been able to do that in like other instances, working with computers in other parts of my life. So I thought that was really great. So sorry about the long story, but so another thing that you can do, and this is, you know, each thing just gets cooler for me, is you can have per-user package management, because each user gets their own environment with their own generations. Each user can manage their own packages without group permissions. And so I've got this, I'm listing out my .NEX profile, and I didn't get to cut it off, but it just points to another part in the store with just other, with like, simply install a bunch of other stuff. And I tried to create a dependency graph of my new store, and it generated a PDF that's like 32,000 pixels wide. So I was like, I can't show that, but it was, it's incredible. It's like per user package management, which is something that's really hard to do with other package managers. And with Nix Shell, you can have, it comes with a command that loads in a set of packages on demand into the subshell. So like this right here, I've got two indications of the same command, which Ruby, node Ruby, and I run it in my main environment. I'm not a Ruby developer, so I don't have that in my environment. And then I have a Nix shell that loads the derivation for Ruby and like points to a version of the system that does have it. And then it runs the same command, and it points to where it is in the store. So, like, I'm not a Ruby developer, but I can have an environment set up like right away. And like, one thing I don't have in the slides, but the Nix has a bunch of language environments, like an index of their own package stores, and exposes it on Nix. So like, it has a selection of package. It has PyPy, it has a bunch of different things. So that's really interesting and cool. Next slide. Okay. Yeah, so sandboxes for everything. No containers required. Don't be docking for that. So it's like this is something that just comes with it. And it's really cool. And I'm going to be using that Nix shell kind of stuff throughout the talk. So you'll be seeing more examples. Another thing with security story, kind of security quality thing, is bad packages are isolated. Like, because each thing is in its own little entry in the store, it doesn't like change the mutable state. It doesn't break other packages. So like for malicious packages, it's really hard to like inject a Trojan horse that other people will then use. And then kind of the more relevant thing for me is that if you have a poorly written or broken package, it doesn't break other stuff. And so a lot of mistakes become build errors instead of system crashes. So another thing, there's this project, is Nix OS reproducible? I'm gonna pull it up here. So this is like beyond normal caching. So according to the report, that like essentially Nix packages is put into like a minimal ISO, and they have, and every time they build it, they check each package to see, is it binary reproducible? Is it exactly like bit for bit equivalent building between two different machines? And the last time I looked at this, it built something like all but 17, or like it was like accessibility was 98.7 or something like that, so it was a lot more impressive than 40%. I was not expecting that, but it's still, it's something that they're building on top of work done by like the Debian operating system, and they're trying to make all the builds completely deterministic, completely reproducible, which, you know, decreases the likelihood for security exploits and for being able to share environments across machines.
So I guess 19 broke a bunch of stuff?
I mean,
because 19 just came out, right? Version 19?
I think, so this checkout is for this specific thing. So they built it multiple times. So like they built this multiple times since version 19 has come out. So yeah, this is like beyond version 19. So that's why it's only tested like, you know, less than half, because they have been building it multiple times. Like I think this page is statically generated by something it says at the bottom here. Yeah, so there's like, this is the code that generates it. Like I just discovered this week, so I haven't really been able to research it that much. Like I'm gonna get to it, but there's a part of this talk I was preparing that like ate up all of my extra time. So like I'll get to it. Oh, let me sorry about that. Let me get this out of here. The hell? Oh, dude. I think it's everything's gonna be fine. Just give me a second. We'll take this moment. Are there any questions so far? I know I've been kind of like going pretty fast here.
Okay. I think there's something basic I don't understand. So let's say you got two packages and they have some common dependencies. You install the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And so then the second one, how does it, those common dependencies are already there, or does it have to redo everything again?
So, there is some deduplication with dependencies. Like typically, if you, if you are requesting a hash that's already been computed, it'll give you that instead of building it again. There is some cases where the store does have duplicate entries. And then you can run a command, we'll go through and look for them and sub out files with hard links. So it like deduplicates space with hard links if symlinks won't work. There's this whole mechanism called garbage collection where it like goes through and like cleans stuff up. And on NixOS, you can turn on the garbage collector automatically, so it just kind of routinely goes through and cleans stuff up. It's very much like the heap in, say, Java.
So without knowing, I was imagining that it was just some like two identical things, or if they needed the same thing?
I know that it's hard links, it probably is symlinks too, like I'm pretty sure there's symlinks, but like I wasn't confident enough in that to like say my talk initially, but I'm pretty sure that's how it works.
I do have to say, I've definitely run my computer out of memory with mixed versions before. If you don't, it has like a pretty easy GC command that you can run and it'll delete the older derivations, but if you don't do that, you can run out of memory.
Yeah.
It was after like a year, but still.
Yeah, okay.
Performance daily updates.
Yeah, we're in treatment sprawls. Or some of these can just be like, you're regularly updating stuff.
Bits on disk, right?
But it could
so the garbage collection that we're talking about is saying, let's take this tree and find all of the disconnected components of the graph.
Take persistent data.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's like a persistent functional data structure, which is a book I had not read. So, I've only been a developer for like 4 years. Like, I was a launch code alumni, so like, there's a lot of stuff I don't know. So, but okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is something called content addressability, which is a really cool thing. I'm not going to click on this link because I just screwed up the browser, but Instead of computing a hash on the package as you build it, if you know the hash already, you can basically request the valid built binary with that hash over the network. So, like I was talking about earlier, if you have your computer and you're serving it up as a binary cache on over HTTP, like your computer could request the hash of something that I've built, and I'll be able to send it, copy it over to your machine, and because it's reproducible, you know that what you're getting and that it's going to not cause your system to crash as well. So like that's why reproducibility is really interesting when you combine it with content addressing. And caches is a service, so there's the NixOS runs their public cache, which allows you to download pre-built binaries for a bunch of common packages. Caches is essentially sort of like a service where you can build your own and push up your own binaries to it, and other people can request it. So it's like this sort of this distribution of binaries, and it's really interesting. And they just released a private version, so if you wanted to have like an enterprise-only set of packages, you could do that with this service. And then the last kind of big thing is that because Unix has a bunch of different programs that run just off just plain text files configuration, you can configure anything with this system. And any file that you add to the store and symlink to install it, you can have the same like atomic changes to it. Like you could if you were generating your file, you could have multiple concurrent versions and just switch between them. And so that's how NixOS works. And there's this other thing called Home Manager, which I also use, that's how it works. And it's just this kind of incredible vision. It's like, oh, you've got this like hash table, and the hash table contains all these things, and you can like build any kind of file system on top of it, and it's amazing. And there's probably even more stuff that I haven't even considered or haven't found through research, I haven't thought of. And so like one of the things I would love to kind of discover through Polyglots is like, is there other cool stuff that we could discover? So with all this like awesomeness, let's go the other direction and talk about this thing, the terrible part of this whole thing. So here's the basic description. The common term for a program in this language is a Nix expression or Nix expert. And I'm going to kind of use that term liberally for the rest of the talk. It's really good to be able to differentiate between Nix the build system and Nix an expression. So I think that's why Nix expert is like a really common term. So some facts about Nix expression language. It's implemented in C++ for portability and speed. Otherwise, it'd probably be an embedded DSL in Haskell, which would raise up complaints. And also, there is implementation of Nix in Haskell called HNix. But I didn't really want to get into it because there's a lot of stuff in this talk already. So I was looking for like a specifying document for the language. Like, you know, most of like, you know, go on Python, it's like, oh, here's the language specification. Or like, you know, you have this like, BNF things, and I'm like, that's really, you know, that's like, oh, like there's like rules for this, but there's nothing for Nix expression language. There's no formal grammar, there's no language specification. It's just what the behavior of the C++ code is. Most of my research is done on the main. And there's some stuff I didn't include. It's like a bunch of functions defined in Nix packages, which is sort of like a standard library. I'm not covering that, I'm just covering the core. So another thing is that it is dynamically typed. If you have internal screaming, do it now. So types are checked at runtime. I have two expressions, 1+1 and string A+1. And string A is just can't coerce an integer to a string. So that's kind of the big, like really basic dynamic type stuff. In the documentation, they do say strongly typed, but like it, I read the what to know before you start debating type systems, and in that it says like, you know, it says strong and weak are basically meaningless, so I didn't include that. So lazy evaluation, if you're not familiar with lazy evaluation.
I caught the org babble thing on the last slide, so shout out.
Yeah, this whole thing was generated with the literate programming features in the word mode. Yeah, that word babble, S-H-E-O-E, I could not figure, I did not have time to figure out how to get rid of that. If there's an easy way to get rid of that, I would love to know. I probably would have had to like post-process, like with elisp, right? Yeah, okay, that's what I thought. I did not have time. It's all generative work. The language is lazily evaluated. If you don't know what that means, I came up with this analogy. Lazy evaluation is like putting stuff in an online shopping cart. You could have something in there for months, years, but until you actually pay for it, it won't show up at your door. That's what lazy evaluation is.
I like that.
Thank you, I appreciate that. The Nick's expression, Nick's experts are purely functional. Once again, this lambda, this idea of lambdas. No side effects, only inputs and outputs are completely dependent on inputs, same outputs. There's no print statement in a Nick's expression. It's all purely evaluated. And it's domain specific. Nick's experts are ultimately for building packages. The design is constrained on purpose. So there's going to be a bunch of stuff that I was expecting that is just missing. So I'm going to start with the unsurprising stuff. The parts of the language that look either like Haskell or JavaScript. So I'm going to kind of group them at the beginning to get the surprising stuff later. So first we have bitwise operators. There's three, and, or, and XOR. No bit shifting, so forget about that. There are numbers, so there are integers and there are floating points. And then the operators, you have basic arithmetic. There's a operator version and a function version each. And the function versions, you know, you can pass as arguments to other functions, like in other functional programming languages. The div slash is overloaded for paths. There's less than, and there's the less than function, which is the only functional version. So if you're doing a map over a bunch of values, you can only do less than. That's it. You can't do arguments. So just gonna have to rearrange things, I guess. And equality operators, there's no functional counterparts for them either, so you can't map equals over things. So good luck with that, I guess. So here's all the operators sort of strung together, and then in order to have numbers coerced into a floating point, you have to have a point zero on one of them. The first thing would have evaluated to one. And then you have map, built-ins, multiply, 1,000 over those numbers, no, 10,000, sorry, 10,000 over those numbers, and you get a list of 10,000s. So there are booleans. The literals are true and false, lowercase. And their operations are equals and not equals, and or. And interestingly, logical implication is the arrow. So if you're like looking at this from a Haskell point, you're like, oh, what's the arrow there? It's logical implication. So if the first thing is true, then look at the other thing. And so I have a little expression there. True implies one is less than three, and that evaluates to true. There's null, which is just null. In the REPL, which comes with the language, you're able to evaluate one thing at a time. It's not exactly like source code, so it's not like Lisp in that way. It's kind of crappier, which is like a lot of things in this language. They're things that exist, but they're just not as good. Anyway, so like a colon T takes an expression and computes the type. So comments, this is something that JSON doesn't have, so that's great. you've got a hash for one-line comments, and then C style, I don't know what you call them, magic wands from multi-line? No. So, let expressions, you know these from Haskell and from JavaScript, I believe. Lexical scoping, you can bind many variables, like in Lisp terms, this is a let star. Later bindings have the earlier ones in scope. So this is something that I saw when I came in, and it just bugged the shit out of me. See that Nix packages thing right there? I'll get to it in a minute, but the angle brackets is actually encoding a type of path in Nix Express, but the program that processed the backorg to reveal thinks that it's an HTML tag. So it's like, oh, look, Nix packages, Nix OS thing. I have no idea how to fix that, and I just saw that coming in here. So, like, one of the reasons I'm apologizing for the quality of these slides is because of things like that that I did not see until today. So, my apologies. But it's supposed to be just angle brackets around certain things. There is, for control, conditional control, it's just if, then, else. That's it. There's no case switch or elif or anything like that. It's just if, then, else, and that's it. And I'm fairly certain that else is required every time. So there's the exception error handling. There's two functions, abort and throw. Abort is like panic. If you abort the passive string, and then the next expression will halt evaluation and print the message as an error message. So like that's the closest thing you get to printing in the next expression is abort. And then throw does the exact same thing, except sometimes it's ignored by certain commands. It's just like, oh, well, you know, we're just not going to print this. So, like, I don't really know what the difference is. It's all magic to me. It doesn't make any sense. Asserts, this is how you do tests. So if you assert a statement, if it evaluates a true, evaluation continues. That's what the semicolon is supposed to mean. And not that it takes two arguments, and then we use it together with the implication, and that's like the example they had for implication. So like, if you have a thing where it's like HTTP server, either true or false, and then HTTPD, which is supposed to be a package, it's like, okay, if HTTP server is true, then we're going to move on to this other thing and check it, otherwise, like, yeah, so that's how you do asserts, and then the assert essentially is just a wraparound. If true, then continue, else abort. So, like, if an assert fails, it just aborts without a message. So, I kind of added some more looking at things with dynamic scoping or with expressions. I read on the internet that these are both terrible and great. I don't know what my opinion is supposed to be. It's definitely a, like with Python, I'm like, yay, great. But like with Haskell, it's like, oh, this is terrible. So like, you know, but so with, like you have with, and then the thing that you pass, the thing that you pass it to, all the attributes within its scope get propagated up to your current scope. So like, the built-ins thing, which I'll get to when I go over more function stuff, has a bunch of built-in functions in it. Some of them are lifted up to the top level, most of them aren't, so you use like with built-ins, and it just like loads all of the sub stuff into that expression. And then in the REPL, there's a command colon A, which does the same thing. But it lasts for the session until you do colon R, which reloads everything. So that's kind of what that means, and you can kind of see all the output. That's like not that interesting. I just kind of wanted to demonstrate how dynamic scoping works. So there, so that's all like the kind of usual stuff. Now we're going to start entering into territory that's a little bit more surprising. But starting off, we're going to talk about strings, and we're going to talk about regular strings. Just regular double-quoted strings like a grand boss used to make. And you, oh, where did that go? I had a little thing here that's like version equals 0.123 or something like that. I don't know where that went. So also, there's no description of how variables are supposed to be named. I couldn't find it, so you just have to guess, I guess. So here's the string literal, no tool is the best tool, and there's a couple of operations. There's from and to JSON, there's a thing where you can hash the string, and you can do some, like not great regular expression matching. So the regular expression matching, if you have something that doesn't match exactly, it just returns nothing. And if you have one exact match, it returns an empty list. It's like, why do you like this? Why do you like this, Dix? Why? Okay, so then the kind of most used string type is double indented. It's two single quotes on either end. It's kind of like a here doc. And you can use it to specify file, kind of file. So like in this case, we're using it to define like a shell snippet that's going to be used, that's going to be run post install. And the way it works is the text is left shifted until it hits a non-white space character, and then everything else is preserved. So it's like really useful for defining files and kind of big text messages and things like that. Unquoted URIs, just URIs, so that's the URL for my talk. String interpolation, aka anti-quotation, replaces variables with their values as long as it is null. Anti-quotations can include any mixed expressions, including those with anti-quotation. So, like, here's an example of an anti-quotation that itself has an if, then, else, and an anti-quotation inside of it. So it's kind of infinitely nested anti-quotation. Yeah, null cannot be anti-quoted unless it's an attribute key. More on that later. So there's a bunch of, you can like do compare versions and split versions. There's no separate versions type. I guess they don't really need it because of all the paths that they have. Path literals are just like Unix paths. Slash is required in the name somewhere. And this is just a thing that irks me. It's base name of, endear of. Why isn't that the same? Why isn't that the same? Oh, why isn't it symmetrical? Anyway, so this irks me the most. They have a function for converting strings to paths, but they removed it and said you have to use this syntax where you plus a slash and a period to the front of a string. Anyway, so the angle bracket style, it's essentially the system searches the next path for a directory that matches that, and then you can kind of have paths off of it. It's a collection of mixed expressions with a default.mix file up top. And this is how the standard packages are loaded in and all that. And the way I try to remember it is angle brackets is for vendor code and slash is for local code. That's, you know, if there's a better way of explaining it, I'd love to hear it, but that's kind of how I think about it. Modularization, we've got this, I'm going on for way too long. So you can import functions and use the import function for names, for qualified imports, and then there's this feature in other parts where you have imports, which just kind of loads everything into the top level and just manages those for you, and unsurprisingly. There are fetch functions that download things from the internet. You need to know, in this expression, you have a fetch tarball, which loads in a particular version of Unix packages that then gets bound to whatever you want in this case. It's just dynamically scoped, but So you can be very specific about the kind of packages you want. It's very, very high level specificity. Lists, oh, sorry about that, wrong button. Lists, zero index, square brackets, no commas. They're heterogeneous. No infinite lists for you because they're strict in length. We've got these fairly standard FP functions on lists, head, tail, length, sort, any, all, concat list, plus plus the concatenation operator, map, filter, but no reduce. No reduce for you. You only fold L hyphen. Only. That's the only one you get. And LM and LM at for access and membership, but anything out of bounds results in a fatal error. There's, you know, that's it. It's kind of classic C stuff. Okay, and then sets. This is the important, this is like, sets is the most important type, so I'm going to try not to go through this too fast. So it's essentially it's JSON, except instead of colons, it's equals, and the semicolons are required. Other than that, it's basically the same. That's why Nick's expressions kind of look like JSON at a distance. And you access attributes with the period, so if you have a set with x in it, and it's, you know, s.x, you get back the value of x. There's this or keyword, which allows you to do a default. So in this case, we have y or default, and because y isn't in the set, it returns default. And this is the only time that or makes an appearance, the only time. Quotation marks can be dropped most of the time with setting the keys. Because they're strings, keys can contain anti-quotation, so you can have like dynamically set value, like keys in your set. And that's when, if the anti-quotation evaluates null, the attribute is just dropped from the set. So like, if you're not careful, you could, or you could do it on purpose, you can like delete things from your set based on string computation. So this is my favorite part of sets. I'm calling them dunder functors because it's very Pythonic and it sounds funny. But if a set has an attribute called named double underscore functor, it becomes callable. And this example comes straight from the bottom of the documentation for sets. This is like the very bottom. It's like, okay, you've got this thing, it's functor, and it's like self plus x. And then you have that set and you merge it with another set that has an x plus 1 if you, you know, inc 1 evaluates 2. And then the documentation says this can be used to attach metadata to a function without a caller needing to treat it specially or implement a form of object-oriented programming, for example. I think I love dunder functors because it's just ridiculous. Like, Nix has half-assed FP, quarter-ass oop. If you add in a fourth of fourth, you probably have a whole language here. I came up with that joke in the shower, so. Okay, so set operations, merge or double slash. The second thing takes precedence if keys are the same. There are two operators that have a static and a dynamic version, question mark. Takes an identifier and checks for membership, and the dynamic version is as adder. And then the static period has a dynamic version called get adder. And I only really understood that like just this week. It's like a lot of the stuff is just really confusing from the documentation. It's not at all clear. And there's like so much more in the documentation. Just like it's all one giant page, and there's no index, there's just a glossary, and it's just really hard to navigate. And like org mode is like old-fashioned documentation, but at least they have indexes and different size chunks that you can view it. Like org mode is better documentation than Nix, in my opinion. Okay, almost done with sets. Attribute scope. Normal sets don't have internal scope. So if you have a set that's x equals y and y equals 1, 2, 3, and you do the .x, it's like unidentified variable, y. It's like, where is that? Because it's looking for y in the outside scope. There's no internal scope. I don't understand why that is. But if you put a REC in front of it, then all of a sudden you get to have self-referential stuff. I don't know why that is, but there it is. And then inheritance, if you have an inherit statement, it just sets things equals to themselves. And then there's this like other version where you have it in quotes, and it just like imports other stuff from other scopes. It's used in import statements. Okay. Okay, so lambdas, this is kind of weird, but whitespace is fine, partial application is fine. There are three styles for lambda literals. You have the style where it's colon, so colon is, the front of the colon is the pattern, and then behind the colon is the body, so that's weird. We can also have sets matching, and this is the pattern that you see most. It's like, it's a set, and it's good. We've got all of these attributes, and these attributes are bound to these variables in the function body. And this is the only way that you can do any kind of typing at all. It's like the closest you can get is like specifying exactly, it's like I need these exact attributes. That's the closest you can get. And then you have variadic, you add in an ellipse, and that's just, I can take in a set of any size, I'm just gonna look for these things. So we have default values with a question mark. Notice the question mark? Like, the semantics of that are not the same as a question mark of the other thing, which confused the hell out of me until yesterday. Like, ugh. And then there's an at pattern, where you can bind the entire set to a variable so you can access stuff in the variadic scope that you didn't specify in the argument themselves. Okay, so, like, and also the commas are used in function arguments, but nowhere else. And like that kind of worked me, but then there's like so much other stuff that's worse that I didn't care about so much. Okay. All right. I'm actually going to really blaze through this stuff. There's like two other kind of things I wanted to talk about. Sort of like, oh, like this language sucks. Are there alternatives? Well, there's Geeks, which is an which released 1.0 this morning. It's implemented in Guile Lisp, so, or in Guile Scheme, so it's like Lisp everywhere. That's great, but they only package GNU-sponsored stuff. Like, so if you want to use anything else, like, you're out of luck. But they don't use systemd, so if you hate systemd, look at GNU. They use Shepherd, which is, you know, such a better name, I guess. Okay, I haven't used it. I think I would need a Lisp or PAL to pair with that. Then there's a thing called DAL. It's DAL y'all. I put that in there because of rhymes. So DAL is this configuration language. It like bills itself as a replacement for YAML, but it does have a Dalton X compiler. But I couldn't get it to work. It broke. It's broken for me. It's broken. And I was like, I was gonna have this whole demo, but it is broken. But I think it's still really cool. It's a typed language, so you can use it when you want types indexed. It's total, which means that as long as an expression type checks, it is guaranteed to terminate in a finite amount of time. So it's a configuration language that will halt at some point, and I think that's a really neat direction for configuration languages to go, so that's why I wanted to talk about it. But I don't really know much about it. I haven't actually used it. Okay, so build system. I wanted to go over the actual useful parts, but I'm really running long on time, so I'm going to kind of try to speed through this. I'm really sorry. So this is actually the part that ate up all my time, getting this whole part right. So let's write an X expression. So one of the things in Nix is that because writing Nix expressions seems so onerous, there's a bunch of tools that allow you to like generate a Nix expression for you. So like there's Cobol to Nix, which you give it a directory with like Haskell code and it generates an expression for you. Or if you have a directory full of Python code, you have a PyPI to Nix where it generates Nix for you with Python. And I was going to use those to sort of say, like, hey, you can, like, take this thing and bootstrap a Nix package and sort of just, you know, go from there, but I could not for the life of me get them to work right in a short amount of time. It's like, it's a starting point, but it does not guarantee a working package, and I was like, I don't have time for this. So I decided to go with my original idea, which I thought was too ambitious, but it turns out I was able to get this done in like 20 minutes. But I wrote a mixed expression from scratch, and we're going to package up Piet. So Piet and Piet specifically. So Piet is an esoteric language that takes in pixel art as input. And so the idea is that you give it a pixel art, and the interpreter starts from the upper left-hand corner, and based on the color it starts on, the little cursor will sort of travel across the thing, and then when it hits a color change, based on how much the hue changes and the direction it's in and everything else, it changes this. It's a stack machine, and it alters the stack machine based on color boundaries. And it's like really weird, and it was invented by the same guy who did Dungeons and Droids and the one with the legs, I don't remember, but it's like this guy who's a webcomic artist created this programming language. And so we're going to build it. So the first thing you do when you're writing a mixed expression is that you have to prefetch the URL to get the hash. So here's a command where I have the prefix scripts right here. Oh, no. I thought that was going to be intermittent. Prefetch scripts is the command, or it is the package, and it has prefetch URL, and you just pass it in the URL, and it returns the SHA-256 hash that you would need to request that. So that is the path. That's like the hash part of the path right there. And then I essentially looked at the basic examples in the manual, and I was able to write this. We have packages, we import mixed packages, and there's a function called make derivation, which you pass in a name and the source and a couple of other things, but all I did was I just included the URL in the hash in there, and the idea is that it takes that in, and if you do the next build, then you'll get a package out of it. It broke because, and I looked at all this and went, no, it broke again. But it turns out it was really easy, because when I looked it up online, turns out I just needed there's a dependency that I need from the next package, is GP. And because Nix doesn't see anything outside of the derivation, there's nowhere in the system for it to be loaded, so I have to specify it. I ran that, and it turns out that Groff is also a dependency, so I just kind of saved the time. And so all you do is you have build inputs, and you put in the packages that you need. And that's how you load your dependencies, by specifying them. And then I was able to build it, and then I was able to install it, and I was able to run the program from all of those three commands with that mixed expression. So I was able to run a Piet program after 20 minutes of writing this. And I've never used it before, and I was like, this is why Nix is cool. So then you can reset the end, you can erase the thing, and then there's that garbage collect function right there. Garbage collect, that's what goes through and removes all that stuff. And I think the first time I ran it, it cleared like a gig off of my disk from all the different things. I'm like, okay, I should run this more often.
Cleared 300 from mine.
It's like, oh, God. And that was with me having the garbage collector on automatically. It was still like, oh, here's a gig, here you go. So real brief tour of the Nix ecosystem. This is the part that I was thinking I was going to rush through, but now I'm like double rushing. Nix OS projects, those are sort of like, there's a Nix OS foundation that's in the Netherlands that kind of control all these things, and they're all on GitHub under the Nix OS organization. It's a collection. So Nix packages, a collection of Nix expressions that define the software that Nix ships with. Inclusion into Nix packages, contributions are done via issues and PRs, and search and discovery are not. great. There's two search tools that together sort of make a decent search tool on the command line, but the only real way of discovering what Nix has to offer is you have to go into the repository and browse the source code. Like, I'm not kidding. That's like the most efficient way of figuring out what it has to offer. So that's a complaint. So there's Nix Ops. So Nix Ops is you have all these Nix expressions that define that's the next slide. Nix OS, you configure the OS in Nix, and basic system configuration is found in Nix packages, and then Nix Ops builds on top of that, where you just have a couple, if you have a bunch of different Nix OS expressions, you can tie them together in a Nix Ops expression, and then you can configure AWS instances with it. And so that's kind of the DevOps tool. Cache NixOS, that's the binary cache that you can use. You can request package builds and you can get them over the internet. Hydra is their build farm. The only one that I know of that's running is the one that just populates the public cache, but it is a project you could run. I'm not even going to mention that. Like that, I can talk about that after, but OSAIL Home Manager is kind of the biggest project that I know of outside of the official thing that you can use. Home Manager, you write Nix expressions to configure the packages on your machine, and you can use it outside of NixOS. You can use it in any Linux distribution and also in macOS, but not with all the features. But it's like a really neat way of, like, you can declare all of your different email addresses. You can declare declare your RSS feed, which I think is really interesting. There's a project called Ori, which was released this month. It's kind of it's like a souped-up Nix shell that uses dranf to kind of make the shell more, make developing in these virtual environments better. And then there's caches, which is the public, which is like the public-private binary caches that you can use. And there's another thing called static Nix, which is like, this is a blog post that just describes using Nix as just like a universal Swiss Army knife tool where you don't have to have like the whole Nix cat, you don't have to have /Nix/store installed, but you can use it to like have shell scripts that just run anything. And it was really entertaining read, so I wanted to include it. Okay, so finally, this is the end. I'm going to try to talk more slowly through this because this is like the important part for me. It's questions for further conversation. Is the Nix expression language redeemable? Is it actually bad? Am I just grumpy? Like, can it be made better if it's bad? Or could we do something like standardize the derivation file format and let any language just load derivations into Nix and just kind of have a language agnostic, like language, a polyglot system that just kind of allows any language to work with it? Would that be a bad idea? Is GitHub the best place for Nix packages to live? Is there a different platform that would be better? One thing I missed is the Arch user repository and PPAs from Ubuntu. Like, could we make a distribution more decentralized for certain things? Could we use something like PFS or DAT? And could we make a GUI for Nix Env? This is kind of the most interesting thing for me. Like, could we use it? Could we do a front end Nix Env that has an app store that does all these really cool things for normal people? And could you do something like that within the enterprise where you have like the InfoSec group in your company, like, okay, we're gonna write all the Nix expressions for all the software that's allowed, and it's just like, and like developers and everybody can kind of work together and all these different things, you can kind of install software without really worrying about security stuff because it's all hashed all. I don't know. I think that's an interesting idea. Thank you. Thank you so much for your patience. There's my contact information again. I really hope that I've contributed to the conversation, kind of started some interesting thoughts. If you have any questions, or anything that I got wrong, or just went too fast through, please, you can either talk to me here, or in future meetings, or you can contact me online. And once again, thank you so much. I wouldn't have been able to do this anywhere else. Thank you.
Are you taking questions?
Yeah. I mean, I figured that I've been up here for about an eon, but I'll take questions.
said to get back to, why go back to the epoch for dates?
Oh, yeah, I did not mention that. So,